Rayla huddled in the basement of a ruined house, clutching her knees to herself. Those lights were still on the back of her head, shining their terrible light. "It's all right, child," the voice in her head said comfortingly. "The fighting seems to be over." "Go away," Rayla snapped at the voice. "You're not real." "Actually, I am, and being insulting to me isn't going to change anything," the voice remarked, voice still cool. "In fact, a little gratitude would be nice. I did save you, after all. What is your name?" "Mine is Maria." "You've damned me," Rayla whispered, clutching her legs more tightly to herself. "I shouldn't have done what I did. I've lost my soul." "Poppycock," the voice sniffed. "Absolute rot. Superstitious nonsense brought about by primitive people. The source is neither good nor evil. Besides, one cannot lose what one does not have." "People have been destroyed by the source," Rayla countered, ignoring the comment about the soul. "How could a soul not exist? How are people to govern themselves without a soul? It's evil." "Evil is a very simplistic term as applied to anything," Maria said, remarked coolly. "The people using it are choosing to use it for atrocious reasons. Simply calling them evil displays a lack of empathy." "Says the person who claims that there is no such thing as a soul," Rayla snapped back. "There is no evidence for the existence of a soul, child," the voice said, tone somewhat condescending. "People have tried and tried to make the claim that there is one, but all we are is a group of animals given sentience. Our minds are what make us different, and our ability to use a source. Those are what make us human." "So there isn't anything spiritual to use the source? Rayla found herself growing somewhat interested, despite herself. "Of course there isn't," the voice remarked. "The ability to use the source is a trait found in roughly a quarter of the population. I imagine that this place might even have a higher percentage due to the bottleneck effect. But I'd have to do a study to really get a handle on the phenomena. Honestly, what do they teach you in universities these days? Herb lore? Stargazing? Tarot cards?" All of the words were invested with a boatload of scorn and contempt. "What's a university?" Rayla asked. Maria paused. "You're joking," she said, Ed finally. "You don't have universities in this day and age?" She sounded shocked and appalled. "No wonder you believe so much superstitious nonsense. No proper education at all." I've had an education," Rayla said defensively. "I know how to plow a field, know how to shoot, know how to shoe a horse." "Oh no," Rayla got the impression of someone rubbing her temples from the voice. "I'm stuck in the head of a farm girl. This is what insanity feels like. If I believed in hell, I think that was where I was." "You're a really blasphemous person," Rayla snapped at the voice. "I'm stating the facts as I see them," Maria snapped back. "Who are you?" Rayla asked, thoroughly confused by the voice's word choice. "Bottleneck effect? Phenomena? University?" It made no sense to her. "My name is Maria Aranel," the voice remarked. "I am a scientist. She trailed off slowly. "I died a very long time ago," she whispered, sounding shocked. "How am I here? Why am I trapped inside your head with access to you or ability to use the source inside you? It makes no sense. And all three power sources in your mind? What are the other two and where do they come from? You should only be able to use Isissa, not Cyrus, and that power." The voice seemed to shiver, though Rayla couldn't tell how she knew that. "Maybe your soul and mine have been combined," Rayla suggested wryly. "Maybe I'm you, reborn." "There is no evidence for reincarnation," the voice insisted. "That's it. That must be why you have access to all three powers. Male, female, and the alien source. And that explains why I can't remember anything after the creature burst through and tried to destroy the world." She paused. But I died. And now I'm alive, in your head, without a body. Abruptly, she started hyperventilating. If I'm dead, that means everything I've ever thought about the nature of life is totally false. What am I? Why am I here? What you said doesn't seem to contradict what I said, Rayla said remarked smugly, trying to figure out what the voice was saying. So many of the words Maria was using made sense in terms of the definition, but how she used them made as little sense to Rayla as if she were speaking gobbledygook. I dismissed what you said out of habit because I automatically reject anything that reeks of superstition, Maria said primly. My hypothesis had actual scientific basis, but that was before this. Now I can't really dispute that idea anymore. Where are we exactly? I can see through your eyes, but I can't access your memory banks. Thank goodness, Rayla thought, shuddering at the thought. We're in Randon Valley, far to the north. Randon Valley, Maria tasted the word. Interesting. I haven't heard about that place. I think there used to be a memorial in the north honoring the champion sacrifice. I wonder, how long has it been since the experiment? The experiment? Rayla asked. The experiment to gain access to the third power, Rayla remarked. How long has it been? Rayla thought for a moment. About 700 years. Oh. Maria's voice was somewhat deflated. So long. Rayla swallowed and glanced around. Can you leave me alone, please? Of course, Maria said. I have some things I need to think about. Abruptly, she vanished. Sighing, Rayla leaned against the wall, then started when she heard two people yelling, Rayla, where are you? Alia's voice. She could be in one of these burned buildings. Damon was with her, voice rising. Mally's steps quickened. She could be injured or dead. Abruptly, she burst into the building and glanced around. Why was Mal wearing her father's hat? Rayla, she yelled, rushing over to Rayla and taking her in his arm. I was so scared. I. Rayla breathed in and out slowly. We heard about what happened in the inn.
Yeah, that works better. Actually. Okay.
Yep. Mm.
Now then.
We heard about what happened at the inn. Damn it. Damon crouched next to them, looking into Rayla's eyes. She shrank back from them, shame curdling in her stomach. However, Elia held her tighter and gently moved Rayla's head to rest on her shoulder. It's all right, Malia whispered. It's going to be all right. Rayla looked up at her friends and swallowed. You're not scared of me? She asked, the flood of emotion she'd been holding down for hours, bubbling to the surface. You're my friend, and that's all that matters. Malia's embrace tightened. The fact that you're a source user doesn't make any difference to me, she said, and intensely. Comfortingly, Damon put his hand and on her shoulder. Rayla, he said intently. You saved those people from getting kidnapped. How you did it is irrelevant. Tell that to my dad, Rayla whispered, turning her head into Malia's shoulder. You should have seen how he looked at me. It was horrible, like I was some kind of monster. You're my friend, Malia insisted. That won't change. Damon nodded firmly. The only reason I'm standing here is because Moran healed me, he put in. Maybe he could help you with that. No, she whispered. I can't do it again. I just can't. Malia squeezed her comfortingly. Whatever you want, she said, voice encouraging. We're with you on whatever your decision is.